good afternoon again. Let's return to work. After this fantastic food, let's return to work. So good afternoon again. Good evening, Professor Tom. Good evening. Welcome back. My name is Piotr Wrubel. I hold the chair of Polish history at this university, and this is probably the organizers invited me here because I hope, like myself, they believe that Polish and Ukrainian histories are closely linked together. So I'm very happy to be here. I'm just a time measuring device. I am supposed to introduce the speakers and then control time and discussion. We are going to be here till 3:15, and we are going to listen to two presentations. First, Professor Françoise Thom from Sorbonne will have a presentation, and then Professor von Hagen will discuss this presentation, and we'll add some additional points. Then we will have questions and answers. So let me introduce our speakers now. Professor Thom is from Sorbonne. She specializes in Stalinist period, but also in the post-Soviet time. She has authored several books on the Stalinist period and on the post-Soviet time. You can see, reading her CV, that her research is concentrated around the early 50s, which could be helpful too as well. She graduated from l'École des études en sciences sociales, where she worked with Alain Besançon, and she will talk for about 30-40 minutes. And then we will listen to comments by Professor von Hagen, who's now from Arizona State University, but he spent over 20 years at Columbia University. Professor von Hagen occupied so many positions that it's difficult to list them all, but among his most important positions were the presidency of the Association for Slavic, East European and Eurasian Studies. He was the president of the International Association for Ukrainian Studies. He directed the Harriman Institute. I am very impressed by the fact that he was on the advisory board of the European University in Minsk, in exile in Vilnius, Lithuania. And I'm also very impressed with the fact that in July 2013, he was elected Dean of the Philosophy Faculty at the Ukrainian Free University in Munich. So definitely we have here someone to participate in this discussion, to comment on the first presentation. Professor Thom, please go ahead.
Do you get it?
Yes, although it could be slightly better.
Yes?
Now it's better.
Maybe when I go closer to the microphone.
Oh, definitely it helps.
Okay,
yeah.
Okay. So I have to be closer to the microphone. Okay. I will try to propose some reflection on the Holodomor, comparing with the situation of diverse regions of the Soviet Union, and also comparing with the case of China, the Great Leap Forward, to see the analogies and of course the differences. between the situation in Soviet Union and in China. The mechanism and the chronological sequence of the great crimes committed by totalitarian regimes are now well documented. But this does not mean that the mystery of those moments of criminal folly engulfing a whole society is solved. We see the links in the chain of events. We know by what arguments the situation were rationalized. We can name those responsible for the crimes, but ultimately a question remains: how can one explain that the instinct of self-preservation of a whole society has been disconnected, that plain common sense seems to have deserted the ruling group and those who are ruled, that elementary moral principles seems to exist? How can the leader impose on his often reluctant followers a spiral of destruction and terror? Why does the ruling group accept to implement policies whose disastrous consequences it understands? Those questions apply to Stalinist Russia, to Nazi Germany, or Maoist China. First, we will try to understand how Stalin imposed the policy of collectivization and dekulakization on the Politburo and the communist apparatus. His tactic relies on dissimulation. For many communists, Lenin's NEP had been a forced and temporary compromise with the peasant masses, but the relative economic independence of the peasants was considered a potential threat to the survival of the Bolshevik regime. Apparently, Stalin could easily have persuaded his colleagues that Bolshevik rule should be imposed on the peasants as on the rest of the Soviet society. But nevertheless, he chose to take his colleagues of the Politburo by surprise, hiding his designs till the last minute. In 1926, when he was still in need of the rightists to defeat the Trotskyists, he criticized Preobrazhensky for advocating a policy towards the Soviet peasantry equivalent of the exploitation of the colonies by the capitalist countries and to ensure primitive socialist accumulation at the expense of the peasants. In February 1928, he wrote in Pravda, "The net is the foundation of our economy and will remain so for a long time." At the plenum of July 1928, he still proclaimed, "Our policy is not to stir up the class struggle. We have no interest in the class struggle taking the form of a civil war." Stalin had so well hidden his game that in early September 1929, Orjonikidze, one of his closest associates, still maintained that total collectivization would take years and years, unquote. That's the first point, is this dissimulation. Second point is war hysteria that Stalin whipped up from the spring of 1927, after the breaking off of diplomatic relations with England following the Arcos affair, and the murder of Volkov, the Soviet representative in Poland, which was blasted by the Kremlin as a new Sarajevo. This has given Stalin the pretext to depict the USSR as a country surrounded by enemies intent on unleashing war on the socialist fatherland. And this in turn allowed to brand any political adversary as a traitor. Already in April 1927, Stalin launches a first trial balloon. He declares, "It is impossible to develop a real struggle against class enemies if we have their agents in our ranks." That's a theme which we come back very often, recur very often later. So dissidents are labeled as traitors, and this background of hysterical paranoia, in my view, is one of the factors explaining the paralysis of society in front of the total offensive of the Stalinist group. In December 1927, Trotsky and Zinoviev are expelled from the Politburo, and as long as organized opposition existed in the USSR, Stalin could not launch disastrous policies because the fiascos could be used against him by his adversaries. But after the defeat of Trotsky and his allies, Stalin knows that he can now take risks. In January 1921, the first extraordinary measures against the peasants are adopted. Already in the summer of 1928, the catastrophic consequences of this policy were obvious. Stalin does not renounce. He resumes political maneuvers, whether against individuals or groups. Stalin's offensives are always gradual, sometimes spread on a very long time. A wave is followed by a retreat, and then a new wave goes further. There is a kind of inexorable crescendo which culminates finally with Stalin's victory. After the first offensives against the rightists in the spring of 1928, when those extraordinary measures caused shortages and a powerful wave of discontent in the country, Stalin is forced to retreat. At the plenum of July 1928, he pretends to be reconciled with the rightists. The plenum recommends to take resolute measures against harmful excesses and violations of revolutionary legality, and extraordinary measures are temporarily suspended. Of course, all these concessions were ephemeral, and Stalin soon resumed the offensive. In the spring of 1929, the rightists were routed. The same scenario of temporary concessions and further radicalization was repeated in 1930 and the following years. In February and May 1930, Ukraine and Belarus were shaken by peasant revolts because of collective humiliation, so that at the beginning of 1930, the Soviet leaders feared that peasants would refuse to sow. At the same time, Stalin worried about the possibility of a joint invasion of Poland by the Soviet Union and Japan. For those reasons, he pretended to offer a truce to the peasants in March, when he wrote his famous article, Dizzy with Success, and momentarily suspended collectivization. This blowing hot and cold, this alternation of hope and certainty of the worst, of radical ultra-leftist policies and unexpected limited relaxation, this succession of abuses and denouncing abuses with exemplary punishment of the culprits explains why resistance fails to crystallize. The French historian Alphonse Allard wrote about Robespierre, il fait peser sur les esprits comme la tyrannie de l'incertitude. In ways on minds through tyranny of uncertainty. This fully applies to Stalin. And from now on, as in early years of Bolshevik rule, each disaster is used as a pretext for tightening the screws. The crisis unleashed by the offensive against the peasants becomes a means of reinforcement of the dictatorship. Chronic crisis and selective starvation become the way to absolute power. The appalling consequences of previous measures led to the adoption of even worse, more radical policies. Combined with the hysterical propaganda about the danger of foreign intervention, the critical situation becomes a pretext to silence opposition. Thus, the severity of the crisis unleashed by Stalin, far from diminishing his power, strengthens his position. The horrendous situation gives him a means of blackmail against possible opponents, who, if not a traitor, would cause a split when the country is on the brink of the abyss. Bukhari, in this case, illustrates the success of this tactic. In August 1928, Bukhari wrote to Stalin, "I already told you I will not fight you, and I do not want to fight. I know only too well what a fight can cost, especially in the serious situation in which the country and the party find themselves." In his speech to the Politburo on January 1929, Bukharin does not mince words in criticizing the peasant policy of Stalin, but he concludes with these words: "The challenges the country faces are so immense that it would be a truly criminal loss of strength and time to unleash a fight at the top." And he asks to be released from his duties, so it's a full capitulation. It should also be noted that Stalin took great care not to confront all social groups at the same time. As in foreign policy, his purpose has always been to avoid the building up of a united front against him. Thus, in June 1931, when he was planning to inflict the coup de grâce to the peasantry, Stalin ended the Cultural Revolution marked in 1928 by the Charité trial, which sparked the hunt for bourgeois specialists. He suddenly discovered that the harassment of experts and egalitarianism were harmful, that an engineer of the old school was not necessarily a saboteur. Finally, we should take into account Stalin's colossal hypocrisy, a permanent feature of totalitarian regimes. Collectivization was first trumpeted by propaganda as a policy of social justice in favor of poor peasants. Only in 1932, Stalin drops the mask, and it becomes clear that the party has unleashed a total war against peasantry as a whole. In his memoir, Kandik Chartiani, who was, he will be the first secretary, later first secretary of Georgia, gives us a striking example of Stalin's hypocrisy. In 1931, Stalin was on vacation in Georgia, he writes. He summoned the leader of the Georgian Communist Party, Samson Bamulia, and the Prime Minister, Lado Sukishvili. Stalin asked Mamulia, "How are the collective farms?" "The situation is bad, Comrade Stalin," replied Mamulia. "Some colchos are unraveling. We have to arm the communists to neutralize hostile elements and keep the peasants in collective farms." Stalin explodes. "You claim that the peasants should be herded into collective farms by the force of arms. What about voluntary adhesion to the colchos? What about the interest of poor and middle peasants?" Thus, Stalin turned against the very people who had applied this policy and playing the role of the writer of wrongs. And it works in a way, those methods works. Furthermore, this modern criminal policy is camouflaged by seemingly rational arguments. Collectivization is justified by the need to urbanize the backward countryside, to modernize production. Stalin, it is said, is fighting barbarism with barbaric methods, but necessary methods, and so far. Stalin wants giant collective farms through which Soviet agriculture will have a scientific basis. The tractor will displace the horse, an army of agronomists will stimulate the development of production based on the collective efforts. This scientist propaganda will even be accepted and spread by some foreign observers eager to minimize the horrors of depolitization and to find excuses for Stalin. As a matter of fact, Stalin was pursuing rational aims through his policy. other aims, he was reinforcing his power. Launching the collectivization, Stalin could, Stalin not only intended to crush the peasantry, he had begun the process which will be completed in 38-39, the liquidation of the old Bolshevik guard and the radical renewal of the party from the bottom up. I think our current difficulties will steal our Bolshevik ranks, said Stalin at the plenum of July 1928, which I already mentioned. Forcing the local Bolsheviks to implement collectivization was a sure means to discredit and destroy them in the eyes of the people. Thus, it was the first step of Stalin's policy of eliminating the older generation of Bolsheviks and replacing them with young careerists devoted to him. The example of collectivization in Transcaucasia, which I know better than other cases because I studied Beria's career, the example is significant from this point of view. Collectivization was used by Stalin as a pretext to begin to dismantle the Orjonikidze clan. From 1929 on, Beria, the chief of the Georgian Gepelu, wrote scathing reports on the disasters caused by this policy, laying the blame on the leading communists, Kartvelishvili or Mamounia, or all the Georgian Bolsheviks, protégés of Orjonikidze. Thus, in March 1929, for instance, after the crushing of an uprising in Adjaria, Beria wrote, "Now the attempt to revolt is liquidated, we have to analyze its causes. For us, there is no doubt that they are to be found in certain measures adopted by the party organizations and the organizations of Soviets which are isolated from the masses and do not take into account their state of mind." Stalin was so enchanted by Beria's competent denouncing of the Transcaucasian Bolsheviks that he promoted him at the head of the Georgian party in 1931 and the party of Transcaucasia in 1932, destroying Orjonikidze's geographical power base. He was so pleased with Beria that he accepted to lower the grain requirements for Beria's fiefdom. Another obvious illustration of this strategy is the replacement of the rightist Rykov, head of the government, by the reliable Molotov, that is the takeover of the government by the Stalinist faction and the party faction, I can say. On September 1930, Stalin wrote to Molotov, "The Council of the Deputies of the Chairman of the Sovnarkom has a tendency to become the headquarters of the opposition to the Central Committee." The solution was to appoint the loyal Molotov as chairman of the Sovnarkom. And on December 19th, Rykov was fired. We have finally a perfect unity at the top of the state and party, which will strengthen our power. The leaders of the party and the Soviet apparatus will form one single fist, said the head of the Ukrainian Communist Party, then Kosio, who had the formal initiative of proposing this measure. In late December, the merger of state and party at the highest level was accomplished. Throughout his war against the peasantry, Stalin will make successive purges in the party, removing layer by layer at all levels those who are suspected of pity for the Kulak, those who have floundered, and this very special selection will create a new party formed by hardened criminals desperate to please the leader. This aspect of collectivization as a pedagogy for the party is clear in a speech by Molotov in March 1930, in which he accused the local authorities of the party for not having taken a sufficiently active role in dekulakization, preferring to rely on the OGPU. The comparison between collectivization in China and in the USSR is very enlightening. The communist system relies on a total deinstitutionalization of power. For this reason, having reached the top of the party apparatus, the ruling despot has only to fear the communist party establishment, the sole limit to his power. The history of both Stalin and Mao's reign can be interpreted as the history of their struggle against the party establishment. In the early 50s, Mao wanted to abandon the policy of new democracy, which allowed the communists to take power in China on a relative moderate program, and to begin, Mao wanted to begin immediately the transition towards socialism. Mao's closest colleagues, such as Liu Shaoqi, were opposed to this new orientation. Mao imposed his view in the summer of 1953, but already in 1955, the disastrous effects of Mao's first collectivization were obvious. In the spring of 1956, Liu Shaoqi and Zhou Enlai concluded an alliance and forced Mao to stop hasty collectivization. Mao was infuriated by this resistance of top party leaders and the solidarity between themselves they had displayed. He chose extreme radicalization to defeat them. In 1957-58, he launched the Great Leap Forward, which caused, as you know, 35 million deaths by famine. The campaign for establishing people's communes was unleashed at the same time Mao provoked huge international tensions, bombing the Taiwanese islands of Quemoy and Matsu in August 1968. So there is also the strategy of international tension launching a radical revolutionary program. The ensuing disaster led to a reaction by the party establishment. In January 62, Mao's policy is criticized by his closest associates, Liu Shaoqi, Zhou Enlai, and Deng Xiaoping. Mao is sidelined in the party leadership. In response, he decides to destroy the existing party and to replace it from bottom to top. He builds his faction with the support of the security apparatus and the military controlled by Lin Piao, then his closest associate, and launches the Cultural Revolution in 1966, which leads China to anarchy and civil war. Thus, Mao turned to extreme radicalism to defeat his colleagues. The analogy with Stalin's tactic is obvious. That's why I brought the Chinese case to your attention. As I have shown, Stalin's aims was to use collectivization to proceed to his own revolution and to get rid of the old Bolshevik guard. As in China's case, revolutionary maximalism was a weapon aimed at the party establishment. Contrary to Mao, Stalin's power was apparently unscathed after the tragedy of collectivization. But nevertheless, historians have rightly pointed out that the Great Purges of 37-38 were an aftermath of the collectivization of 32-33. The trauma left by this experience in the party was deep. The mysterious Kremlin affair in 1935, which led to the demise of Yanukitze and prepared the ground for the later purges, reflects the turmoil in the higher circles of the Kremlin. As Mao, Stalin decided to build a new party in 36-38. During the Great Purges, the accusation of having disapproved collectivization often pops up. In his famous speech at the Military Council on June 2, 1937, Stalin heaped reproaches on Yanukitze. "Can you imagine," said Stalin, "this bastard Yanukitze felt pity on the peasants, and as he can play the simpleton, this beanpole, people believe him." After his arrest, Frinovsky, Izhov's deputy, confessed that Yevdokimov, the former chief of the secret operation of department of the OGPU, told him at the time that he thought that he saw the liquidation of Kulak's move wrong, and that he didn't believe in the success of this policy, as he was convinced that it would ruin the villages and destroy agriculture. So
Professor,
there are many examples. Professor Tom,
please, yes? please forgive me. But it would be great if you could approach towards your conclusion.
The microphone. Yes. Okay. Is it better now?
Yes. No, I'm asking you, please, approach your conclusion.
The conclusions. I said the microphones.
No, the microphone is fine, but I'm responsible for time measurement here.
Okay.
Thank you.
I am close to the conclusion.
Great.
The last point is the reinforcement of personal power for Stalin and reinforcement of the power of the Soviet state are one and the same thing. And that's the second aim, which explains the organization of famine in Ukraine, in my view. Stalin decided to in 1928 to transform the Soviet state into a war machine. Part of the military-industrial complex had to be built in Siberia for security reasons, and Stalin needed an enslaved workforce to implement this ambitious plan. And preparation of war also led to distressed population of the border countries, and especially Ukraine, taking into account Stalin's obsession with the Polish danger. So Stalin knew, as I have shown here, that Poland was not a real threat, and when he launched the famine measure in Ukraine in December 1932, in January 1933, he was he had no reason to fear a Polish aggression, because there was a Soviet-Polish treaty just a few months before. So that's the last point. How much do I have left?
Well, let's say 5 minutes.
Okay, so as a conclusion, I think collectivization and famine and the Holodomor should be analyzed in the line of the policy of revolutionary regimes as a whole. All revolutionary regimes strive to implement irreversible measures. In Jacobin France, committing regicide, executing King Louis XVI, and later annexing Belgium, was perceived as crossing the Rubicon, cutting France off from Europe, and making total war inevitable, and thus consolidating the revolutionary dictatorship. In the USSR, the collectivization and the Holodomor was such a Rubicon, with the similar aim of isolating the country and depopulating the borderland of the untrustworthy population. In Nazi Germany, the final solution chained the German people to the sinking Hitlerian regime. Strikingly, the same expression crops up in the last two cases to justify this policy. According to Baumann, to eradicate, Baumann was secretary of the Moscow Party Organization, to eradicate definitively capitalism in the countryside means to blow up the bridges so there is no way back. This is the expression Goebbels used in his diaries commenting the final solution. He says, we have gone so far, especially in the Jewish question, that there is no longer possible to go back now. And it's better this way, a movement and a people who have cut the bridges behind them fight more resolutely. So you see, there is a kind of logic and a will to commit irreversible measures in a way of stabilizing the revolutionary regime. I think the analogy is striking. I have tried to show in this paper how Stalin has single-handedly imposed this calamitous and criminal line to his followers and to resisting masses. We have seen that as in Germany, in Nazi Germany and in Mao's China, radical nihilist policies are camouflaged by the state ambition to build a great autarkic conquering empire. But ultimately, we still do not understand how a dictator can lead his people to self-destruction, and the mystery remains. That's my conclusion.
Professor Paul, thank you very much. And please stay with us.
Yes, okay.
Professor von Hagen, you have about half an hour. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Grubel. I actually have been working on the relationship of the Bolsheviks and the Soviet state to the peasantry from my very first book on the Red Army. And as there I found early 1920s, a discussion in the Red Army political department of raskristianivanie, which you've heard earlier today from Professor Graziosi, which is the de-peasantization. Some of the most ardent Raskristianiteli in the Red Army were former peasants who hated their peasant backwardness and wanted to distance themselves and the Soviet state from it. So I've been also dealing with the Soviet state and the peasantry ever since I started writing about these things. I'd like to come back to Professor Tom's reflections on the Holodomor, which recalled for me a perhaps unfortunately titled book by a dean of Cold War diplomatic history, John Lewis Gaddis. We Now Know, Rethinking Cold War History. Thankfully, Gaddis was far more cautious than the somewhat triumphalist title might have suggested in his evaluation of the impact of material found in Soviet and East European archives, as well as recently declassified American archives. Professor Thom, with no such caution, declares that the documents made available after the fall of communism vindicate the totalitarian interpretation. She understands that interpretation to emphasize the role of ideology and terror in the communist regime. It stresses as well the role of Stalin as a decisive factor. The revisionists, she goes on, focus more on society and a structuralist approach. True to her self-identified affiliation with the totalitarian approach, she concludes her paper with the following categorical pronouncement. We have tried in this paper to show how Stalin had single-handedly imposed his calamitous and criminal line to unenthusiastic followers and to resisting masses. In my nearly 30 years of teaching Soviet history, I have insisted that my graduate students familiarize themselves with some of the best works of scholars identified with the totalitarian interpretation. Leonard Shapiro's History of the Communist Party of the Soviet Union, Merle Feinsod's Magisterial Smolensk under Soviet Rule and How Russia is Ruled, and others. All of these scholars devote considerable attention to terror and ideology and Stalin, but I can't recall any of them making a claim that Stalin ruled over the country single-handedly, nor that all the masses were unenthusiastic and resisting. In fact, Professor Thom's characterization of Stalinism is a caricature of what these earlier scholars tried to explain. By now, I thought no serious scholar would try to argue that one man single-handedly ruled over 150 million people, but Professor Thom appears to believe this, and that every one of those 150 million resisted Stalin's wishes. Moreover, I also find it curious, and I'm glad, again, that Andrea gave his paper first, who learned something from going to the archives. Professor Thom seems so satisfied that the archives have only vindicated her old beliefs about the Soviet system, and that we only have more details to add to our previous picture. For myself, I prefer to have my previous positions challenged, as well as the paradigms in which I tried to situate new archival documents and their meaning. I was trained by historians who passed on their intellectual mission of critically questioning all prior knowledge, but basing that criticism on a solid foundation of past scholarship. Unfortunately, here too, Professor Tom disappoints with her presentation in that she is not at all recontextualizing the Holodomor, but seeks to rehabilitate totalitarianism and resituate Stalin's Soviet Union together with Nazi Germany and Communist China. The isolation of Ukraine's Holodomor in this narrow range of comparisons replicates the Cold War marginalization of Ukraine's history in these 20th century dictatorships. Still, I would like to extract something from Professor Tom's writings that might help contribute to the mission of this conference, namely the recontextualization of the Holodomor famine in various historical debates and literatures. I'd like to start from her final paragraph, again, which she summarizes how her three totalitarian dictators' radical nihilist policies are camouflaged by the stated ambition to build a great autarkic conquering empire. On the first page, Professor Tom reminds us of Stalin's criticism of Preobrazhensky for wanting to exploit peasantry like colonies in 1926. Finally, I'm going to draw attention to a quotation from P.A. Valuyev that starts her paper, Devastation as a Principle of Government. This is unprecedented in history. The quotation refers to Russian policy in Poland in the 1860s, but she never returns to why she shows that quote. In order to make some sense of that, I want to return to another classic of the literature of totalitarianism, perhaps the Ur classic, Hannah Arendt's The Origins of Totalitarianism. Arendt famously, among other things, sees the origins of concentration camps in European imperialism, more particularly British imperialism, in the British Boer War of the late 1890s. Recently, several historians have taken up her old challenge and begun to see more colonial roots of Lenin and Stalin's policies, and that could be extended to 1991 at least, and post-1991 to post-colonialism. An important debate sees the great European powers bringing back home to Europe in World War I the colonial attitudes toward warfare, toward population movements and occupation regimes. Stalin, as a quintessential borderlands ruler, much like the young Turk officers who seized power in Ottoman Turkey and oversaw the Armenian massacre that has gone down in history as the first internationally recognized genocide, was familiar. Stalin was familiar with colonial warfare from his experience in Russia's civil war, at least, where all former boundaries regarding combatants and civilians were erased for a new understanding of total war that, without modern industrial technology, by the way, that nonetheless made for horrendous mass atrocities on all sides of the conflict. The Stalin-era collectivization, I would like to argue, and the attended famine, Holodomor, can be seen as a particularly brutal exercise of colonial power by a regime that has been described as pursuing internal colonialism, most recently by Alexander Etkin. And I'm glad that Roman Serbin also raised this to refer back to the Russian Empire. And an earlier reference was made to former students of mine, Peter Holquist and Jochen Helbeck, and Peter Holquist also is beginning to move our origins of Stalinism to World War I, at least, if not earlier, in the colonial wars of late Imperial Russia. And in the papers we've received for this conference, we have frequent comparisons with the Holodomor to Communist China's famine, as Professor Tom did, and Cultural Revolution under Mao. Other references are made to Pol Pot's Cambodia, but a couple comparisons have not been evident in these papers, and I want to, since I was in organizing the conference, I did have a chance to make some input, but I didn't make it in time. We don't have a panel on what the Holodomor teaches us about famines and comparative famines. And since Roman Serbin brought up the question of Russian colonial power, we could also talk about comparative imperiology, to use Kimi Thaku's Matsisota's phrase about this. Both the Irish famine of 1846-48 and the Bengal famine of 1943 occurred within the confines of the British Empire and in different centuries, and both were at least partly man-made. And the attitudes that were exhibited by British officialdom in both cases were not much more humane or empathetic to either Irish or Indian peasants than was Stalin to Ukrainian, Kazakh, or other peasants during collectivization. And I don't want to say that Stalinism equals the Irish famine and that they're all morally equivalent, but I think that the Irish famine represents a phase, as does the Bengal famine, a phase in the development of colonialism and imperialism that might also help us recontextualize the famine. Recently, Tim Snyder has placed the Holodomor, though he's chastened by Norman Neymark for eschewing the term genocide, in the center of a discussion about mass killing in the 20th century, suggesting that Hitler learned from Stalin's murderous famine in Ukraine and felt empowered to launch his own genocidal campaigns against Jews, Slavs, Roma, and homosexuals. Several historians have challenged Snyder on several accounts, but most insist that the Holodomor is more a culmination of trends in Ukraine or the East European borderlands and not the beginning point. That at least World War I and the Civil War, possibly the First and Second Balkan Wars that immediately preceded the World War, the 1904-05 revolutions, and also possibly the anti-Jewish pogroms of 1880s in the Russian Empire. I would argue that Hitler's European empire also practiced new forms of colonial exploitation, as did Stalin. And what we get in both of these empires, and it's become much more politically correct to refer to both Hitler's Germany and Stalin's Soviet Union as empires. Mark Mazower's work on the Nazi empire, Ron Suni, who refused to call Soviet Union an empire for a long time, now leads the way in referring it as that. So I think that if we look at the way empires treat their colonies, and again, you could even consider the Russian peasantry to be a colony, that what Russia is doing is in line with, although more extreme than, and other empires have done. Snyder, like Professor Thon, also returns our attention to Hitler and Stalin as the most important forces on either edge of his bloodline. Several critics have pointed out that he largely ignores the role played by local East European militants, in the words of German historian Felix Schnell in a new book, or nationalist entrepreneurs in another scholar's work. He thereby appears to let Ukrainians, Poles, and Lithuanians, among others, off the hook for the atrocities of the 1930s and 1940s. Professor Thon dismisses the revisionist focus on society and structuralism, but it is precisely in the study of perpetrators, victims, and bystanders that some of the most exciting research has been done. And it seems to me, and again, Andrea Graziosi raised this point, that this is one of the future horizons of Holodomor research, is the story from the bottom, that which, despite all the testimonies, has not been incorporated into our understanding of these events. I think that Professor Thon somewhat insultingly dismisses these concerns to come to her astonishing vindication of her caricature of the totalitarian school. And I want to make a kind of counter argument that if we look at, again, starting with Andrea Graziosi's Soviet Peasant War of 1918, already in 1918, I recently come upon, thanks to some of the people here, Pavlo Christiuk and a kind of Ukrainian anti-colonial critique of Russia from 1918 already, when the Ukrainian Rada is faced with the Bolshevik Red Army in what might be, unlike what's Benedict Anderson said, it wasn't Vietnam, Cambodia, and China who were the first socialist states to fight, it was Ukrainian Socialist Republic and Russian Republic, and that already then Ukrainians understood that Russian socialism was imperialist, and they weren't disabused of this. As when, unfortunately, Pavlo Hristiuk went back to Ukraine when it was now Soviet Ukraine, and together with Pyotr Brzezinski and all of the other Ukrainian anti-colonial intellectuals of the 1920s, which might be seen as a kind of temporary decolonization of the Russian Empire, but just temporary. All of those people were suppressed, and I think there was a reason they were suppressed, because they were telling a truth that was too hard for Stalin to understand or to accept. I mean, he perfectly understood that he was, in fact, a Red Emperor presiding over a callous exploitation of not just the Ukrainian peasantry, but especially the Ukrainian peasantry, and that this is something that I think we might divert us in a different direction. This critique of colonialism, by the way, was repeated in the second decolonization of Ukraine during Khrushchev, when Ivan Zhuba, in his famous internationalization and Russification, basically went back and said, he didn't ever say the Soviet Union was colonialist, but he said it acts like the Russian Empire, which was colonialist. So in fact, he did say that the Soviet Union was a colonial power, acting colonial in Ukraine. So, and again, what happened to Zhuba and all the people who shared that opinion? Ended up out of a tribune, and sometimes in jail in the Gulag. So if you want to, again, and I haven't worked this all out, but I'm developing this counter argument to suggest that Russia might have experienced what Hannah Arendt calls about the moving of colonial warfare to European territory earlier. And I have recently been studying the Russian-Chechen War, the 19th century one, which lasts almost 70 years, and was a colonial warfare with attrition, with destruction of villages, with destruction of murder of innocent children and women. And that was the legacy of the Russian army entering into World War I. If you read the accounts of the Russian army in Galicia, occupied Galicia, they are waging a cultural war, first of all, against Jews. And there's a recent historian, Alexander Pusin, talks about Russian military pogroms in Galicia in 1914-15. They also, by the way, shut down everything Ukrainian and arrested Metropolitan Sheptytsky and sent him off to a penal monastery for the rest of the war, and closed down Ukrainian clergy, Ukrainian cooperatives, certain ones. I mean, of course, there were Russophile ones which benefited from the occupation as well. So this pattern of the Russian army identifying categories of people to exterminate or to emasculate or whatever term you want is, I think, already here and only exacerbated in the Civil War. And this is another lesson, I think, that we can learn about Holodomor as a stage in this kind of colonial exploitation by first the Russian state and then the Soviet state. The last thing is on the question of suicide and sui genocide, which was, I think, raised in a paper I read. I can't remember which paper I read now. Coming from Peter Struve and an attempt by Russian historians to understand what happened in the revolution and civil war. One of the most hopeful things, and I like to kind of leave things on a hopeful note, is Arseniy Raginsky from Memorial in Moscow and Karaganov, who's one of Putin's leading advisors, have come up with a new concept that all of Russia should view itself as a Katyn, that all Russians are perpetrators and victims and bystanders, and until Russians recognize what they have done to themselves, there's not going to be a hope for an improvement in Russian politics or in East European politics. And again, I don't want to excuse the United States from this imperialist, colonialist critique. I think our last few wars have been somewhat colonial, and we're reaping the consequences of those now. And so I think this would help put Ukrainian history and the history of Stalinism back in a bigger picture in which we could begin to see that, of course, there are different imperialisms, there are different colonialisms, but they all want to exploit resources of the population, and they seem to view a good part of their population as less than full first-class citizens and who are therefore can be manipulated and killed and deported and otherwise have their lives made miserable. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We are about to open the questions and answers period, but before we do this, Professor Tom, would you like to answer Professor Hagen?
I have some problems to answer such an onslaught. I think our task as historians is first to try to understand the causes of the events. Saying that Holodomor was a result of a colonial post-policy is not, it's a play on words, it's not an analysis of causes. I think if you want to understand the history of Soviet Union, you have to understand what goes in the head of Stalin, what he is thinking, because he is the one, I'm sorry to insist, maybe seeming a remnant of the totalitarian school, an archaic remnant of the totalitarian school, but I insist, I beg to differ, the key to understanding the Soviet policy in the 20s and in the 30s is to understand, in the 40s also, is to understand what went in Stalin's head. If we don't do that, if we don't try to understand that, we cannot account to the turn of events. There is absolutely no reason to starve 6 million Ukrainians. How does your colonial theory account for colonial exploitation? It's not putting to death people who who are supposed to produce wealth. It's not an explanation. I think it's just a play on words. So the key explanations have to be seeked in the top of the party. What happens among the ruling groups? It is true for China. It is true for the Soviet Union as well. And if you apply this sociological approach, you renounce consciously to understand the specificity of what happened in Soviet Union or under communism.
All right, thank you very much. But please stay with us because now you will answer questions.
Okay.
Yes?
Okay.
Or would you like to add something more? No?
No.
Good, all right. So let's answer questions together now. We will take three questions, and please come up to the mic, because Professor Don should see this. Professor Plochy, please go ahead.
Thank you. Thanks for very interesting presentation and certainly thought-provoking comments. Now you can hear me. So I spent the last 30 seconds thanking our presenter and commentator for those who didn't hear me. I should say that the first time I read the correspondence in the summer of 1932 between Stalin and Kaganovich, I was really shocked and surprised to what degree Stalin really was the one was calling the shots and deciding what will happen and what would not happen. And what was coming from Kaganovich and Molotov was maybe in support of those ideas. So I was trained to think in terms of big social forces and political groups coming together to formulate the policy. And I was surprised to what degree it was one man who was really calling the shots. That being said, I felt really not very comfortable to some parts of the main presentation where Stalin was presented basically as an all-powerful evil deity who has this vision, who has this plan, and then uses dissimulation, hypocrisy, and other things to get there, and tactical retreats. He did all of that, but from my research on Stalin during the Second World War, immediately before and during the Second World War, what I learned is that he didn't have his mind set. He adjusted not only in terms of tactics, but in terms of strategy and setting his goals. And that's where I think, given the importance of Stalin and people at the top, I agree here with Professor Tom, but still I'm uneasy about these people knowing right away from the very beginning, having this plan and trying to execute it. So I wonder whether you could comment a little bit on that, whether there is any development at all of Stalin's thinking, and if there is, to what degree it influences the situation and policy regarding peasantry, but also the policy that led to the Great Famine of 1932-33. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
What puzzles me is the extent to which the two sides are so arraigned against each other in terms of the interpretation of these events. To my mind, an imperialist analysis of the whole of the waters, it seems logical, and the totalitarian model is equally so. They simply provide two sides of the dynamic, and as Professor Tom pointed out, the point at which the whole of the war occurred and has systemic roots in how he proceeded to consolidate his power and how he expressed it, and the imperialist roots of the social organization of what territory the Soviet Union came to control is equally a it strikes me as a reasonable way of approaching why one might put down a source of opposition. So, if anything, my question is, can't you get along?
All right, thank you very much. We do have three questions. Professors, who would like to start this? Professor von Hagen or Professor Tom? Professor Tom, would you like to answer the questions?
Okay. As far as the first question, of course, Stalin is a Bolshevik. That means that he follows the interest of power, as he perceives it, his interest of powers. But he's also an opportunist. He sees what occasions arise and how to use them. So it's true Stalin during the war had no preconceived plan. He had a few possibilities in his mind of what he could attain, and he was waiting for the development of events to see which possibility would concretize and what use he could make of it. So I don't want to show Stalin as a dogmatic who's completely fixed on one plan which is in advance, constructed in advance. No, Stalin can adapt to situation. By the way, I showed how he adapted to the situation, to his perception of the correlation of forces in the Soviet Union, and he can fully change his. Though his constant preoccupation is to reinforce his personal power. That doesn't change. As far as the second question, the question of the Jewish genocide and the genocide of the Ukrainians, I tried in my presentation to show how those extreme policies can be explained by a revolutionary dynamic. I had too less time to develop this point, but I think it's a very promising line of research, of course, to compare the European revolutionary dynamic. The last question was, what was the last question? Yes, about the two conceptions. It's true, I agree, by the way, I wrote in my paper that Stalin's policy was partly to be explained by his imperial designs. I wrote it in the paper, I don't deny it at all. What I insist on is that we should not refuse to try to understand what happened. And a purely sociological approach, in my view, is a refusal to conceptualize what happened. I have proposed a few lines of, it's not explanation, I try to propose lines of thought, lines of research, eventually for students, but showing the parallelism between the Maoist situation and the Stalinist situation. I think there are some interesting aspects to be developed. I remain adamantly convinced that we have to understand what happened at the top of the party, of the power machine.
Thank you. Yes, please go ahead.
I'd like to, I'm glad that Professor Tong acknowledges that Stalin had imperial aspects. I'd like to come back to the Irish famine, since I haven't had much chance to say anything about it. I'll be very brief. On the eve of the famine in 1846, Ireland was the breadbasket of Britain. 7 years later, Ireland had lost more than 1/8 of its population, 1 million to death. During the famine, 1 million to immigration. Most historians think that it was not until the 1970s that Ireland actually was able to reverse this demographic decline, so over 100 years. The British, by the way, have never apologized to Ireland for this, and yet the lieutenant The Lord Lieutenant of Ireland in 1847 said, "Eskimos and New Zealanders are more thrifty and industrious than these people, who deserve to be left to their fate instead of the hardworking people of England being taxed for their support." That wasn't from Stalin, that was from the Lord Lieutenant of Ireland, a British official. And church officials were equally unchristian in their attitude toward Irish Catholic peasants. So I think this is, you could ask, why did British imperialism want to starve its population if they were interested in keeping things going? And here, I think that's a good question. Why did they want to starve them? Thanks.
Professor Sisson, please go ahead. Yep.
Yes, I think it's wonderful to have a professor of Polish history as a chair at the moment.
It's so famous.
Because he will immediately respond to the Russia is a radish theory. That is, that all Poles and Western Ukrainians said that, after all, red it is on the outside, but we know it is white within. And I think we have come close to this at the moment. That is, on the one hand, we have the issue of communism specifically, and then Stalin as a phenomenon within communism. And the other, we have had now a discussion of colonialism, anti-colonialism, and comparisons that go back to the Russian Empire. And this, of course, these arguments have played a great role since World War II, if not earlier, in all of these discussions. But I thought that when we aim this conference towards younger people, and then old people get up and tell you the way things were once and why things are this way, things you probably know very well, but we repeat it anyway. And what I felt during this was this is the generational, in my case, divides of seeing the interpretations of the Soviet Union change. That is, from the time when I was at the Harvard Russian Research Center, and Adam Ulam, who doesn't always get put in the line of the totalitarian school fully, but obviously was interested in Stalin and the mind of Stalin and taught a whole generation, to the generation of the revisionists that wanted to see revolution from below. And certainly it depended where you started in the field as to what you viewed was the danger. I still belong to the people who, when the rise of the revisionists came, and I found that their description of what I could see of the Soviet Union seemed to have little to do with explaining larger phenomena, I'm worried about it. We hoped that we were going to get by this by now. That is, we were going to be able to have both. That is, we could put Stalin back in the story, and yet we would be studying other social factors. And of course, with it, at least generally, we saw a revolution from below decline in, let's say, its popularity in the field. So what I got the feeling when Andrei Vinitsky wonderfully said, can we get this all together again? I think that also the aim of the panel was specifically Stalinism. And of course, from that, Stalin is essential to understand Stalinism. How great a role, I still would hesitate to say, and then I'll end this monologue fairly soon, that one could not picture what happened in 1932-33 happening without Stalin. That is, I think the school that would view that communism had this inherently and would have developed in this direction anyway, we cannot say what this bit of history was, but what we can say is that certainly the figure of Stalin, as Sahib Lucky has brought up in his own research from World War II, is essential in looking at these phenomena. The other side is that, of course, Stalin is not fully sufficient. That is, you have to explain the structure beyond it, and I think that's what Mark Hagen has tried to turn us towards. So with this commentary, which will not resolve the problem, but at least might go through the issue with me. And of course, and a lot of this also depended when you studied the Holodomor and the Ukrainian famine. I, in my initial discussion, brought up the agenda of the Ukrainian emigration to put the famine on the issue. And one of the most, I think, difficult issues to understand is why the revisionist historians were so little interested in the Ukrainian famine. That is, the disruption of those below was not as interesting as revolution from below. So that in the 1980s, you got relatively little resonance from them in this field. And of course, the totalitarian school or their successors were much more open to the idea of looking at the Ukrainian famine, and that certainly marked a lot of his study. So with that comment.
And let me ask a question too. If I can recall my Marxist education, wasn't it so that from the very beginning Marxists and communists had a problem with peasants, and the ideology didn't really know what to do with peasants, and for a long time, up to the 20s, the peasants were not workers' partners because they were a strange group which did not fit, really? So this is my first question. How much ideology contributed to this? Because someone, Professor Sissin, asked, how about this scenario without Stalin? So how about the ideology? And my second question is, could you tell me, please, how many non-Ukrainians died during the Holodomor, particularly how many Russians died? And was there any reaction to this on Stalin's side, or he didn't care at all, and it was unrecorded, basically? These are my questions. Professor Tom, would you like to start? Closer to the mic, please.
About 5 to 6 million is that the figure we have for the victims of the Holodomor in Ukraine. The worst case was in Kazakhstan, where almost half of the population was destroyed at this time. And as for the reaction of Stalin, Stalin was completely callous to this suffer. It's obvious in his correspondence with Kaganovich. He didn't really, he chose to confiscate, how do you say in English, les semences, the grains for the next, even the sowing was confiscated. This is not really a colonial policy, it's a genocidal policy.
All right, I have a line, so don't be patient, please. Professor von Hagen, would you like to add something?
I think that Marxism did have problems with the peasantry, beginning with the Marx himself. And if you look at the first Russian Soviet constitution, peasants are given 1/5 the vote of urban residents. Peasants are discriminated against in membership to the party. They're discriminated against in all facets of Soviet life, wherever there's some privilege or discrimination to mete out. Peasants are second-class citizens. From the very first constitution the Soviet Union Soviet Russia puts on the place. So I think you're right. And that's why I'm saying if you add this kind of hostility to peasantry that comes from Marxism on top of Russian imperialism, now Soviet imperialism, you get a peculiar brilliant form of imperialism that, you know, wasn't completely like British imperialism or French imperialism or other imperialisms, but nonetheless might be compared to Germany, where also another radical ideology was added on to an imperial colonial kind of policy.
Thank you. Professor Sternschis, please.
You spoke about how famine helps us to understand the general issues of, and place analysis of Stalin's Russian his empire. And it's very interesting to me to look at it, not only for the position of state policies, but I'm curious what you think about how studies of famine can help understand Soviet subjectivity. It's a growing field in Soviet studies of experiences, how people from below negotiate. And I'm thinking about strategies of who lives and who survives and how. How decisions make about who stays and suffers and dies from famine and who is saved and how. And how do the government policies facilitate those decisions or don't facilitate those decisions. So I'm curious whether studies of feminists perhaps study over violence can help us understand those ways to survive the Soviet society.
Thank you very much. Dr. Kuzio, please. I do control the line. I do control the line. Never.
I can't resist as a political scientist bringing this to the contemporary era. And particularly as you talked about, President Reagan talked about Memorial in Russia and the views about dealing with our own political, our own guilt or views on this period. So let's look about Ukraine today. Ukraine is now nearly a quarter of a century independent. 30% of Ukrainians believe Stalin was a great leader. It's an opinion poll from this year. The political party that has won the last four elections in Ukraine has permitted the statues of Stalin to go up in eastern Ukraine in the last 3 years. And it's the party that's won the last four elections. And it's a party that voted against the war and the famine in 2006. And a party that's in denial about the whole war. There are countries in Europe that denied their involvement in World War II, Austria, for example. I don't see any statues of Hitler in Austria, although the extreme right is quite popular. I'm just wondering if you'd comment about this phenomenon, how this is a very unusual case, I don't know anywhere in the world, where a political force that's in power in Ukraine, and of course, Viktor Yanukovych in 2010 went against the position of the first three Ukrainian presidents on the Ukrainian family. He, in effect, took upon himself the Russian position.
All right, thank you very much. It goes so well that we will accept two more questions. Please go ahead.
I'm Kimberly St. Julian from Harvard University. Since we're talking about contextualizing Stalinism and using the Holodomor to understand this, we heard the use of victims and perpetrators earlier, and this is something you hear a lot in Nazi historiography, but you don't hear that in Soviet historiography. And I wonder, for you, Dr. von Hagen, do you think the dichotomy between perpetrator and victim is useful in our understanding of the Holodomor and then placing that within Stalinism? And for you, Dr. Tom, does that complicate your ideas about Stalin and his single-handed implementation of these really strict measures? Does that complicate your idea at all? That there are individuals who took part in this, who understood what they were doing, and still support Stalinism?
Thank you very much. Go ahead, sir.
I'm Mark Yanichonsky from Stanford. Listening to the discussion so far, a thought popped into my mind, and I wanted to ask it. Maybe this is a provocative question, but since the idea is to ask what the Holodomor teaches us about Stalinism, and you see the two sort of different positions sketched out, one is about emphasizing the centrality of Stalinism, while the other emphasizes the broader context, the history of colonialism, the history of exploitation, economic exploitation, other kinds of exploitation. So I wonder if we're struggling with, we want to account for the culpability of Stalin as a historical actor, but while also paying attention to the fact that he didn't invent this out of thin air. He came to power at the top of a state that had a context, that had European empires around it, that had examples that it looked back to. And so I wonder if we have these two different viewpoints to account for, I wonder whether we might want to question the whole category of Stalinism to begin with, because Stalin was one particular leader at a particular place and time. So that's sort of my provocative question is, can we talk about colonialism and about Soviet history without trying to generalize about Stalinism as a specific set of policies and institutions that came that appear on the historical scene in this one place and time, but then are exported to other places around the world? So I wonder if Stalinism is useful, if it's useful to generalize about Stalinism as a discrete model.
All right. Thanks a lot. Professor Tom, would you like to start?
Could you repeat me the questions? I lost a little. What question must I answer?
Well, it would be very difficult to repeat all the five questions. So let's do this. We will start with Professor von Hagen, please.
All right. Okay. There was a lot entangled in all those questions.
Yes.
First of all, I don't think colonial and genocidal are necessarily mutually exclusive. You can have a colonial power in all sorts of places that can be genocidal. Not all genocide necessarily are colonial either, but so that's coming back to the bigger question of trauma and the Holodomor. One of the problems in Ukrainian history, and it's a problem not for historians as much as it is for Ukrainians who've lived through its history, is that for the 20th century, Ukraine has been involved in either war or serial multiple occupations. You might say till 1991, if you consider the Soviet occupation to be an occupation, but certainly World War II, there's a German occupation, there's a Soviet occupation, and Polish occupation in Western Ukraine. There's World War I, where you get a Russian, German, Austro-Hungarian, Polish occupations, Reds, Whites, as someone mentioned earlier today. So Ukrainians, again, have been by unfortunate circumstance, comparative imperiologists, just if they stayed in the same place, and through the course of the 20th century. So to separate out the famine, the Holodomor, from this greater set of traumas, I think is going to be very difficult for any social scientist or even any trauma specialist, but it's got to be a piece of it because it helps condition the rest of the suffering, I think, that the populations who live in the territory of Ukraine endured. So, and I would even say Chernobyl is another example at the end, and I think Lena Kostenko made a very good sort of poetic evocation of the ties of Holodomor and Chernobyl, again, as I would say, evidence of a kind of colonial attitude of Moscow toward its borderlands, and even toward its own not-so-borderlands, its homeland. And I think that also gets to the question of perpetrator and victim and bystander, which is central now to a lot of the research on the Holocaust, and I think should be central to the research on Holodomor too. And again, I said that some of the worst people who wanted to de-peasantize the peasants in the Red Army and who got chastised for this, at least in the mid-20s, were peasants who were rejecting their past, just like many Jews in Soviet. If you read Yuri Sluskin's book on the Jewish century, some of the most anti-Jewish Bolsheviks were Jews who were fleeing from the shtetl and who wanted to reject all of that and who became very violent and callous towards suffering. So I think, you know, the question of perpetrator is not a black and white question, perpetrator and victim, all the time. Sometimes it is. But it also involves, again, the Holodomor was not single-handedly unleashed on the country by Stalin. He had tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, of NKVD officers or OGPU officers, local party people who were loyal to him, and they were resisted by probably an equal number, if not a greater number. But that question, I think, is definitely central to understanding this event, this horrendous event in the broader history of Ukraine and the Soviet Union, if not Eastern Europe.
This is the last round of questions, so this is your last chance, and then we will have closing remarks. Professor Srebren, please. Yes.
Two brief remarks. First of all, when I was beginning to study Soviet Union, I studied Lenin more than Stalin, because to me Lenin was somebody, he was a lawyer, he was trained to manipulate and so on, whereas Stalin for me was a butcher. This is what I believed until I really read Stalin's correspondence with Kaganovich. And then, and we discussed this with Professor Graziosi, remember, I realized that he was really the best student of Lenin. He knew how to manipulate. Now, if you take what he says to his Politburo people, a month or two later, you'll find it on the level of the activists in the village. This is amazing. Sometimes even the same words are used. So I think the power of Stalin was not just, you know, that he had the formal control. He was able, he was very savvy, he knew how to use it. And the other point I just like to make is this thing about the law of five sheets of wheat. Now, if Petrovsky on the 10th of June writes to Stalin that there is famine in Ukraine, and he's complaining, and we need help. Actually, Kapanor gets the letter, he sends it to Stalin. Stalin writes back 3 days later, Ukraine already got all it needed or should have gotten, they can't give them any more. This is the 15th of June. On the 18th of June, this is the first time that I saw Stalin mention the word famine. He says there's famine in some regions of Ukraine, although the harvest was good and so on. On the 20th of July, Stalin writes to Kaganovich, he says, I propose that we promulgate a law, and this is the law that you mentioned.
Yeah, sure.
This is very important. He was already working. Now, on the 7th is the law, but what is more important is on the 11th, 4 days later. 4 days later, Stalin writes to Kaganovich, and this is this famous, you know, the quotation that everybody quotes, but very few actually interpret it. And I would invite everybody who's interested in that to come to my session tomorrow. We'll go into detail on that. Also, I have a little handout I'm very happy to give to you, so you can read at home and be prepared and come to the session. I only have 20 minutes tomorrow, so, you know, I have to make it. That's why I have to abuse it here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Professor Graziosi, please.
I have a question that, of course, is not simple, so I'm sorry to ask it, but for both of you, that is, of course, we know that, like everything else, that's why it's easy to be a historian. Stalinism is an historical object. That is, Stalinism is something that evolves. The Stalinism of 26 is not the Stalinism of 29, not the Stalinism of 33, not the Stalinism of the war, 41 or 45. So the question, according to you, because I think this was also the spirit maybe of the organizer, how the Holodomor changes Stalinism? In your, that is, what is the influence of the Holodomor in the evolution, not only of Stalin as a dictator, but of Stalinism as a political, ideological, because Stalin was a politician. He liked to expand theoretically. This, how did Stalinism evolve after the Holodomor? Can we consider the Holodomor a turning point in the evolution of Stalinism or not? But this is my question.
All right, since the question is heavy, let's ask Professor Tom to answer this question.
I think it's a very good question. I think Holodomor changed, of course, Stalinism. It was a turning point. It was a deep trauma for the party, even if the power of Stalin in, on the surface was strengthened, but it left deep, I think, deep scars, which were apparent later, during, as I said, during the Great Purges. It made the Great Purges inescapable. It was a consequence of Holodomor, in my view. And it was also to be felt at the beginning of the war, in the beginning, the first months of the war. There was obviously a defeatist trend, which can only be explained by this experience. And I think there was a big testimonies upon to show that there was a deep defeatist tendency in the Soviet Union at this time, because people remembered all those kulaks who were deported to Siberia, who dreamt of being liberated by the Japanese and so on and so on. So the scars which were left were deep, and Stalin maybe got a feeling of the precariousness of his power, in spite of his victory on the party, on the people. He never forgot that his power was in a way precarious. And it explains a lot of the crises of the late Stalinist period So Oyedolo was really a turning point.
Thank you. Professor von Hagen, would you agree that after the Holodomor, the great pages were unavoidable?
No, but I would like to answer Andrea's question on a different point of view. I don't know if the conference was meant so much to evaluate the impact of the Holodomor on Stalin's thinking and Stalinism as a system. And I think you did a very good job of talking about how the collectivized agriculture and all that went with it made for a kind of permanent crisis in the Soviet economy that was acknowledged by Soviet economists up to the very end and even afterwards. But what I think what did change importantly, and you can, there's a lot of evidence for this, is the secrecy and the lie and the taboo on, because it was something that obviously they at some point were not proud of as an accomplishment and not willing to. And the fact that they spent so much effort in the post-war period defaming the Ukrainian diaspora and making every mention of this a sign of collaboration with the fascists and et cetera, and assassinating Ukrainians abroad. And again, some Ukrainians didn't deserve to be assassinated, but played very complicated roles in the 30s and the 40s. But the fact that the Soviet regime until 1987 could not admit this horrible tragedy, I think did affect the kind of truth realm of the Soviet state to its very end. And to come back to Taras's question, I think that isn't gone today. I mean, colonialism doesn't end when the Soviet Union comes to an end. That's true for Russia, that's true for Ukraine, that's true for all sorts of other countries that lived under that regime, as is true for British colonies after the British Empire ended and the French colonies after the French Empire ended. So colonialism and decolonization is a long, maybe it's an eternal process, I'm not sure. You might begin to think that we have it in our bones somewhere, colonialism, but again, Chernobyl is the late Soviet manifestation of this, the lie, how they tried once again to say that there was no nuclear disaster, right? But then a crisis happened and things turned around, they had to admit it. It was no longer possible to hide this from the international community.
All right, thank you. In a minute or so, we will start closing remarks, so be ready for this. But before I do this, let me ask you the last question I always ask my students. Is there any disagreement here? Is the person who would say, professors, you are absolutely wrong, it wasn't like this? Okay. Professor Sisson, great. You see, you thought you would provoke me.
I'm the only one that's got the authority to say so.
No, the issue came up with the conceptualization. And since I was part of the conceptualization, a group where, did we really, what were we driving at when we threw Stalinism in as a topic? And to be honest, now when I think of it, I don't know how much we thought of Stalin the person as opposed to Stalinism the phenomenon. So if there were two topics that I would have thought we could have perhaps developed in would be one, Stalin. And when we go to the Holodomor, it was obviously research on the Holodomor and what has it told us? Has it told us about Stalin personally involved? Has it told us something about Stalin's attitudes towards Ukrainians? Which of course is a much debated issue and we only have fragmentary knowledge of phrases Stalin says, what he says after World War II, suppositions of what his mindset may have been. But you know, as I stop to think of it, perhaps, and this would then go over to what is the system set up after 33, 34 in the rural areas that Professor Katsiosi did with, but can we call that the Stalinist system, which obviously had much deeper social implications. That is, it was going to divide the world of the villages to those who were given the food to survive, who were part of what this new system was, and those who were going to die, many of them, or those who came from the people who died and the change of it. So what I must say is, you know, probably we didn't have any deeper thought of it, but I thought it was, might be worthwhile at least to say what I think the issues that we were driving towards. I realize Stalin, the person, is always going to. Only Adam Ulam really understood the mind of Stalin. Maybe he can tell us these things, and we can't do that. But this system that is set up by the Holodomor, what we want to know is, by studying the Holodomor, do those people who look at Stalin and Stalinism and that society, has it impacted them? And at times, I think the answer may be negative when I look at a lot of the literature in the field. It's getting a little bit better that the Holodomor is read into the 1930s in the literature. It certainly wasn't there 30 years ago. You know, it was something that was totally on the side of those things.
So are you saying that Stalin disliked you Ukrainians more than us Poles?
I didn't say more or less. Okay. He feared you more.
All right.
There were incredibly from his side more of us.
Oh, well, that's arguable. Professor Andrzejewski, please.
Actually, I can make a follow-up point to that. Stalin was terribly suspicious of all social groups and social networks. He spent his entire career unmaking social groups. And it's not just nationalities. We keep talking in terms of nationalities. He did the same thing with the Communist Party of the Soviet Union. He did the same thing with the returning war veterans after the Second World War. And so in that way, I mean, this debate about who suffered more and who suffered less, if we look at it from the perspective of the Kremlin and the perspective of Stalin in particular, he didn't like any social groups.
I mean, this was a joke, obviously. So. Disagreement? If so, please come. Disagreements. A simple question would not be tolerated, but a disagreement, yes.
It's a very serious disagreement, and I really welcome Professor von Hagen's kind of intervention of Professor Tong's presentation as a caricature of the totalitarian school, not as let's look at the way Geyer or Fitzpatrick looked at totalitarianism. Here we have, you know, we have to answer the question, what does the study of Holodomor has brought to the study of Stalinism? And unfortunately, I don't think Professor Pond's presentation really contributes anything new to our understanding of Stalinism. We don't need the Holodomor through our characterization of Stalin to bring anything new. I think what Professor von Hagen was doing was offering, through this kind of colonial critique, a way to broaden out, to say, look, there is, we can think about this in a wider way. My challenge here is that maybe you can disagree with me, but that initial thrust I found the most stimulating, and then somehow the discussion has somehow peered out into, yes, you know, there's someone, the figure, and then there's the context. And I don't think that's really does justice to the way I read it, Professor von Hagen's initial introduction.
Maybe, thank you. Maybe this is a matter of different perspectives, European and North American. But please make it short because time is flying.
I disagree with him. I don't think that it's necessary at all points to say something new, as it's necessary to say something clearly and to form a clear framework into which one can place understandings of events. And I think Professor Tom did an excellent job of that. And I think that the analogies that she drew to Mao were very well taken, and to Hitler as well. So, no caricature from my point of view, sorry.
Go ahead.
Okay, I'll try and be quick. Here's where I don't agree with both of you. So, Professor Tom's paper points out an interesting contradiction, which is there is an incommensurability between punitive rationale of colonial extraction or even transformation of society at the same time as causing massive amounts of death for that population. Okay, so how do you answer that question? So you pointed out when you said not all genocides are colonial and not all colonialism is genocidal, but really then colonialism ceases to be an explanation here, possibly. So, and I would go in a different direction. One thing that I pulled from the sources that I think is really interesting, that at all levels, when people say who is dying, why is it happening, this comes out, they say the slackers, the good, are dying, okay? Now this is a narration, okay, of a narrative which indexes a set of cultural logics, okay? And that's actually, as Professor Solomon pointed out, reflects in a legal framework. So that is the direction I would go in, is to try and understand the cultural factors and how we can, the way we can study them are in these narratives which are produced, which are in officials' reporting. Okay, and that is why I think the local level is very important, more important than the level at which Professor Tom's paper is focused on. And it's something that gets beyond reifying a colonial system as a cause, just as the Soviet system is reified as a cause in Professor Tom's paper. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Professor Tom, you have 5 minutes for your closing remarks.
Well, I think I wanted to propose some hypotheses to explain what happened. It's very difficult to happen explain why the government would choose to starve 6 million people. I tried to propose some beginning of explanation, but I see that I did not really convince many people. But nevertheless, the colonial hypothesis seems to me very inadequate to explain what happened in 32, 33 in Ukraine. Colonial powers have an interest in more or less preserving the lives of their subjects and not bringing them to starve. The behavior of the Stalinist faction was irrational from the point of view of the rentability and economic point of view. It was thoroughly irrational from the point of view of Stalin, which was a point of view of power. Power of the Soviet state, of the Soviet state over its citizens, and power of the Soviet state as a preparation of war against countries of Europe. So from this point of view, it was completely coherent and logical. But a colonial explanation is not adequate to the phenomenon. I'm sorry, I beg to differ.
Thank you very much. Professor Verhagen, your closing remarks, please.
Thank you, Professor Rubel. I want to thank James for challenging me on this, and I guess I'm not speaking very clearly yet, but maybe if I speak clearly, it that makes sense. I don't want to say colonialism was the cause of the Holodomor. I want to say colonialism is an important context to within which all sorts of other things happen. Colonialism is not an essential category. I mean, the British imperialism in the 18th century was not British imperialism, the 19th century wasn't imperialism, the 20th century is the same thing with Russian imperialism. It evolves over time, it is different from region to region, and I think the richness that we have in imperial history now is that we acknowledge that empires are different, but they do have some things that they do in common. They have to control their colonies at some point or another, and sometimes they control them more humanely, and sometimes they control them more genocidally, and I think this is a case where, for a variety of reasons, including the accretion of a very hostile to the peasantry ideology in Marxism, at least in the version that Lenin and Stalin introduced. And again, this is something that Ukrainian social revolutionaries were saying as early as, even before 1918, in the pre-revolutionary period, Ukrainians were sensitive to the fact that Russian socialists tended to be sometimes imperialist vis-a-vis the non-Russian peoples, and also toward peasants. And given that the Ukrainian social revolutionaries that I've been infatuated with lately kind of focus on peasants and Ukrainians, they felt the brunt of Russian, particular Russian version of Bolshevism that triumphed in the revolution and civil war. So I think that's also an important thing. I don't discount ideology at all. I think imperialisms can operate with different ideologies. The liberalism of the British Empire also allowed for them to say things about Eskimos and New Zealanders as opposed to Irish peasants. So it's not just imperialism, it takes other things, but that colonialism is an important context in which we can see everything until, I think, even to today.
All right, thank you very much. thank you very much for your patience. Goodbye.